Hari Om. Today we are taking up the last two mantras, 10 and 11 or 11 and 12, whatever the case may be. This is the last two mantras of chapter 2, section 2 of the Upanishad. Particularly the first mantra, what we are taking up today, mantra 10, or mantra 11 in some other text, commencing from Natatra Suryo Bhadi, is a very, very important stanza, and it has to be explained fairly well. So, in case I transgress upon your valuable time, I must apologize for that, and pardon me for that transgression. Because this being the concluding two stanzas of chapter 2, I thought I must do justice to the stanza also, sacrificing a bit of time. So here we go. The 10th mantra reads, Na tatra suryo bhadi na chandra taragam Nemad vidyudo bhadi kutoyam agni Tameva bandham anubhadi sarvam तस्य भाषा सर्वमिदं विभाति एंड द नेक्स्ट मंत्र लास्ट मंत्र सेज ब्रह्मै वेदमृतं पुरस्तात् ब्रह्म पश्चात् ब्रह्म दक्षिणदश्चोत् उत्तरेण अधश्चोर्ध्वं च प्रसृतं ब्रह्म वेदं विश्वमिदं वरिष्ठं इति द्वितीय मुंडके द्वितीय खंड. So these are the two mantras that we are going to take up today. The literal meaning, as usual, is the first mantra, the 10th mantra. The sun does not shine there. I am giving a literal translation. Nor does the moon or stars. The lightning also do not shine, the ultimate supreme. How can then the earthly fire ever illuminate your supreme status? Surely, everything shines because of Him who alone truly shines. The whole world is illumined with His light. Is the meaning of first stanza. The second stanza is, this immortal Brahman is above, above means above you, below, in the front, at the back, on the right, on the left. It is everywhere. All this world is indeed the supreme Brahman. Now let us get into the explanation portion of it. Now, as I mentioned, with these two mantras, this chapter concludes. That's the second chapter of Muntaka Upanishad concludes. The penultimate mantra, the last but one mantra, that is the 10th mantra, Na Tatra Suryo Bhadi, is a very efficacious and effective mantra. Please understand this, believe me. Even today, when we have almost forgotten our beloved Upanishads, our Mother Shruti, we still hear this mantra from the lips of almost all pujaris in temples or any other place where any puja is performed after or during the time of arati, that camphor arati we do. Now tell me, how many pujaris and devotees has ever come to understand the import and significance of this mantra is another matter altogether. We are not commenting on that. But the silver lining in the whole thing is that this particular mantra has its prominent place even today, after thousands and thousands of years. Therefore, I would urge all of you to learn this mantra by heart. It is not difficult. Na tatra suryo bhadi na chandra taragam nema vidyudo bhadi kutoyam agni tameva bandham anubhadi sarvam tasya bhasa sarvamidam vibhati. Please learn this by heart. As I said, this mantra is generally chanted as the pujari offers camphor light to the Lord. Now, if you carefully analyze the mantra, a self-interrogation is built into this mantra. You are asking a question. The pujari, while offering the camphor light, asks himself or the Lord, "Look, sir, the sun cannot shine you, nor the moon, nor the stars. The lightning also is not capable of lightening you. How can, sir, then this small little man-made camphor fire ever light you, or ever reveal, or ever shine you?" It cannot. We know it. After all, your effulgent nature lends power and energy to all the phenomenal objects to shine. In short, the whole world is illumined by you. This is the gist of this mantra. Now, when we say that the sun and the moon and the stars and the lightning, etc., cannot illumine the Atman, the reality, the Self, the Supreme, it should not be quixotically interpreted to say that, that means your Atman, the Self, the Supreme, the reality, as a very strange and strong opaque covering of some lightless gas like carbon dioxide that prevents the light from penetrating. Oh, I see. That is the secret. Please don't ever try to interpret the mantras like that, as you like. You have no right to interpret the mantra as you like. The declaration of the rishis has to be taken as intended by them. And what in modern terminology we call it as the legislative intention. When the laws are passed by the government of India, any law is passed, they write there what is the legislative intention of this. The government makes it very clear, this is the intention of the legislature. No one can bypass that intention and interpret in a manner agitating that intention. Therefore, the statement only means that a small matchstick lighted during a summer midday is not at all capable of illuminating the sun, the bright sun above. A small matchstick. Nor its own light will be visible. Not only the matchstick cannot light the sun, the light of the matchstick itself will not be visible because of the effulgence of the sun. Therefore, the point to be understood here is that all phenomenal powers like the sun, the moon, the stars, the lightning, etc., 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 are illumined by the Atman, the Self, the reality, and as such, None of them can illumine the illuminator. Careful. None of these phenomenal powers can ever illumine their illuminator, namely the Atman. Once the illuminator withdraws its power of illumination, the illuminated will cease to exist. Again, come with me. Once the illuminator withdraws its power of illumination, the illuminated will cease to exist. But if the illuminated perish, the illumination still remains. Now, if from the beam of a torchlight, the dining table which it was illuminating is removed. The torchlight was illuminating a dining table in a dark room. So the illuminator is the torchlight. The illuminated is the dining table. Now the illuminated, the dining table is removed. What remains is the beam, which is the illumination. It cannot be illuminator because there is nothing to illumine. There is no object available to illumine, therefore the light alone remains, the illumination alone remains. Nor of the field minus the field theory, don't forget. Now, assume for a moment that after a long, long, long period of time, the earth vanishes, right? Not today, tomorrow. In fact, it has to vanish. It has to vanish one day or the other. It's a question of time. Today, tomorrow, or day after tomorrow. That's all. And when it vanishes, the sun, the illuminator, do not vanish. It still remains throwing its light, but nothing to get illuminated. The sun keep on throwing the light. There is nothing to get illuminated because the illuminated has perished. Just because the illuminated has perished, just because the illuminated has perished, the illuminator cannot close his shop and say, there are no customers, therefore I am going back, Hari Om, back home I am going. No, it will keep on illuminating. Now go a step further. The light of the sun comes from where? The light of the sun comes from the materials process occurring in the sun, within the sun. There is a material process occurring in the sun for it to generate light. The light emitted by the sun is not his own. And therefore, the sun will die one day. Maybe later than Earth. It will die one day. And that is referred to as the heat death. The extinction of the sun is referred to as the heat death in science. When all the hydrogen in the sun is converted into energy, it will be thrown out of this universe. Then the sun is no more the sun. He is a retired government official. No power. Therefore, the light of the sun is also relatively temporary and not absolute. But here, the light of all lights, which is eternal, infinite and indestructible, is Atman, the Self, the Supreme, the Reality. Men may come and men may go, but I go on forever, sang a little brook. But the products of modern science, as we are, we may get rather rattled at our Vijnanamaya kosha level, the intelligence kosha level, when we read these mantras. That is because we have conditioned our intellect only with the knowledge of a limited science. The scientists will tell us the entire history and geography of the sun, the moon, the stars, and except their sources. Rest everything they will tell you. They would say that the earth is a portion of the sun, was a portion of the sun, and that it has fallen down from the sun and got held within the web of mutual attraction of the planets and cooled now to the modern temperature. Sir Isaac Newton of AD 1670 seemed to have taught us this law of gravitation theory, which is finding a place in our physics textbooks. Even that elementary scientific truth, which was discovered, the word used is discovered, not invented, discovered. It means it was there, it was covered. So Newton has only discovered the law of gravity. Even that elementary science of the law of gravity was declared by Newton in 1670 AD. But the rishis of the scientists of our Bharat, called as rishis, the scientists of life called the rishis, has declared the same thing. When? In AD 528. When did Newton say this? AD 1670. When did our rishi say this? AD 528, 1100 years before the grandfather of Isaac Newton was born. And even today we say, who discovered the law of gravitation? Isaac Newton. This was said by an ancient scientist of India, Rishi of India, called Bhaskara the II in his Bhaskariyam. Siddhanta Shiromani, it is called in Goladhyayam, Bhuvana Kosham, stanza number 6. I will present that stanza for you. It says, Akrishti Shaktistu Mahitayayat Khastvam Guru Swabhimukham Swashaktiya Akrishyate Tat Patati Vabhati Same Samandat Kapatatyayam Khe. The meaning is, Nagrishti Shaktistu Mahitayayat Khastvam Guru Swabhimukham Swashaktya. Whatever objects in the firmament are attracted and subject to the force of gravitation will fall on the earth. Then why earth is not falling down? Why everything is falling on the earth, but earth is not falling down? It is remaining there as a planet. That is because Agrishyate tat parividhibadi. Why? Same samandatko patatyayam khe. But when it is pulled to all directions in equal force, how can the planets ever fall on the earth? Gravitational force from all four sides are pulling in equal strength. Therefore, since it is pulled from all directions in equal strength, that object must remain stationary in the firmament. This is declared by Bhaskara the II in AD 528, 1100 years before gravitational law was so discovered. Anyway, that is not our subject for discussion. What I am trying to say now is that, is, in fact, this is besides the point. But what I want to convey to you is, if we ask the living representatives of Sir Isaac Newton and his dedicated team of scientists one question, you said all this, you said everything, history and geography of the sun. Tell me one thing, sir, where did the sun itself come from in the firmament? I didn't say when it came, from where it came. They feel uncomfortable and would be tickled to a justifying temper, isn't it? They lose their temper. Please understand that science has its limitations and can only revel in the Vijnanamaya Kosha and not beyond. But our saintly rishis have satisfactorily answered all the questions raised by curious students and by the science. Therefore, where the science is silent, philosophy becomes eloquent. The mantra under review finds its content reflected in the 15th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, when the Lord asserts, Yada dityagadam tejo jagad bhasya dekhilam yachandramasi yachagnau tat tejo vidhi mamagam. Tat tejo vidhi mamagam. What a powerful statement. Please understand that tejas to be me. The light which is residing in the sun, yad aditya gadam tejo jagat bhasya yathekhilam. That light which is residing in the sun illumines the whole world, and that which is in the moon and in the fire. Know that light which are in these equipment, enlivening the entire world. Know that light to be mine. Mine means whose? That of Purushottama. Verse 15th chapter is Purushottama Prapti Yoga. So the 15th chapter belongs to Purushottama, and in 15th chapter Bhagavan says, this light which the sun and the moon arrogates to itself, strictly speaking, that light is mine. I am that light. Not that the light is mine, I am that light. Know that light to be mine. Hence, that light belong to Purushottama, ever effulgent, ever shining. Purushottama, Uttama among the Purushas. He alone is Purusha. Bhagavan alone is Purusha. All other creations are not Purusha. Meaning what? Stri. Yes. Stri is a combination of three abbreviated words. Sa, Ta and Ra. Sa, Ta, Ra, those three are abbreviated. Together we call it as Stri. World Health Organization. Who? So Stri means Sa, Ta, Ra. Means that who possesses the qualities of Sa, Ta and Ra. Sattva, Tamas and Rajas. All living creatures, big and small, all of them possess these three qualities in varying degrees. To them, tamas may be maximum. In some of them, सात्विक में भी मैक्सिमम, इन सम ऑफ देम रजस में भी मैक्सिमम, देयर मे बी अ मीरियड ऑफ कॉम्बिनेशंस ऑफ परसेंटेज ऑफ दिस थ्री केमिकल्स शैल आई से और मूड्स, नॉट केमिकल्स, दे आर मूड्स ऑफ ह्यूमन बीइंग्स, गुणास दे आर कॉल्ड द नेचर. So that creature or that creature which possesses the sattvaguna, tamoguna and rajoguna in varying degrees is called a stri. And he who does not possess all these qualities and are beyond the three qualities, he alone called a purusha. And among such purushas, he is uttama. Uttama purusha. So that light belongs to him. Now the section concludes by declaring that the ultimate cause of this world of objects, feelings and thoughts is the Brahman alone, and it is all pervading. This is the last mantra. It is the immortal Brahman. And with this teaching, the Rishi concludes chapter 2 of this Mundaka Upanishad, and tomorrow onwards we'll start chapter 3, section 1. We have two more sections to go in this third chapter. Let us see if God willing we will continue it as much as we can and see what further points are being raised by the rishis. What are the definitions, what are the nature, and what are the other things that he is going to speak to us on the Brahman, the reality. With this, let us close for the day, and I once again crave request you to kindly bear with me for the delay, more so yesterday and today, for the extra time that we have taken, but this was unavoidable. Hari Om.